Welcome, everyone. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to the Wyoming Presbyterian Church on this 12th Sunday after Pentecost. My name is Reverend Gilha, and I'm a youth pastor at Korean Community Presbyterian Church in Atlanta. It is such a blessing to worship with you this morning. You'll need a copy of the bulletin to follow along with. You can find it attached to the weekly email or on website at wyomingpresbyterian.org. Let us now praise God by singing the opening hymn. You can find the words printed in your bulletin. Our scripture reading for this morning is Acts chapter 14, verses 19 through 23, and Galatians chapter 6, verse 17. Here's God's word spoken to you. First, it's Acts chapter 14. But Jews came there from Antioch in Iconium and won over the crowds. Then they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing that he was dead. But when the disciples surrounded him, he got up and went into the city. The next day, he went on with Barnabas to Derbe. After they had proclaimed the good news to that city and had made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, then on to Iconium and Antioch. There they strengthened the souls of the disciples and encouraged them to continue in the faith, saying, "It is through many persecutions that we must enter the kingdom of God." And after they had appointed elders for them in each church with prayer and fasting, they entrusted them to the Lord in whom they had come to believe. Now it's Galatians chapter 6. "From now on, let no one make trouble for me, for I carry the marks of Jesus branded on my body. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." As I begin today's sermon, I would like to share this memory that I had from my childhood experience. I think I was either 4 or 5 years old when one of my mother's friends and her children visited my house. While this is something parents should never do here in the United States, it is often acceptable in South Korea, where I'm from, for children to go outside on their own because it is quite a secure and safe environment there, and even more so back in the 80s. So what happened back then was that while the kids, including myself, were playing together, my mother gave us some money, a little money, for us to go out and buy some snacks and ice creams at a grocery store. And as a way to get to the grocery store, there was a shortcut. It was rather kind of dark, back street route kind of road there. But we often went through the shortcut because it was shorter way there. As me and my sister and two other friends, about the same age, heading to the grocery store, we encountered unexpected trouble. There were scary gangsters in front of us who were actually elementary kids. Whereas for 4 or 5 year old kids, elementary children were really huge and looked really strong and scary. And some of them was like chewing the chains, chewing the gums, asking us for the money that we have. As we saw them, like all of a sudden, we all turned back and run as fastest as possible, trying to run away from them. And my younger sister fell down while she was running, and I had to turn back again, pick her up, and tell her to run again. I was so scared to turn back again toward those elementary kids, the gangsters, and it was so scary. That we, after coming back safely, thankfully, to our home, we told our mothers how we met the scary gangsters on the back street. And from that day on, actually, whenever I had to go to that grocery store near my home, I never ever took that shortcut again because I was so afraid. I was so scared to meet those scary gangsters, the big elementary kids who tried to take our money and tried to beat us, doing bad things for us. It was a traumatic event for me. I was so scared. The word trauma, as we know, the dictionary definition of the word means a body wound or shock produced by sudden physical injury as from violence or accident. But this word is mostly used in a psychiatric sense, meaning an experience that produces psychological injury or pain. The word trauma is actually a Greek word. And as we all know, our New Testament is written originally in Greek. I looked up this word trauma in New Testament, and there's only one instance that this word has been used in the New Testament, which is Luke chapter 10, verse 34, where it talks about the parable of the Good Samaritan. As we all know, one man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he meets the robbers, and those robbers stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. And in verse 34, a Good Samaritan passes by and bandaged this person's wound. And the wound here, the word is trauma. The Greek word trauma, when you look at the lexicon, it means wound, hurt, damage, shipwreck, and so on. And this word also is used in a verb form, traumatizo, meaning to wound, in Luke chapter 20 and Acts chapter 19. So as I have shared my own child story, which was a traumatic event for me, but that event in some sense is actually just a funny little old memory coming from my childhood, which may not be so serious. However, as I have been serving as a pastor at many churches and counsel many people and get to know their personal stories, I encounter so many people who suffer from serious traumatic experience. A person who was beaten by his father who was an alcoholic. A girl who experienced terrible sexual abuse. A person who lost their beloved ones from accident. A person who had to go through serious economic crisis and etc. Whenever we encounter these unwilling experiences, which is like a huge wall that blocks our path, that we walk along the path of our lives. So many people are captured by their past traumatic memories and cannot move on from there. Some people give up on themselves, losing all their hopes, and constantly affected by the bitterness that comes from their trauma and get their lives destroyed. In today's scripture passage that we read together, we can see that Paul is also going through a serious and dangerous incident that could easily leave a traumatic scar in his life. To fully understand what is going on in today's passage, we should carefully follow Paul's mission route starting from chapter 13. In Acts chapter 13, After Paul encounters Jesus on the way to Damascus, the church sends Paul and Barnabas on a mission trip. They first visit the city of Cyprus, and they experience wonderful, miraculous work of the Holy Spirit there. And after that wonderful experience, now they move on to the next city called Antioch of Pisidia. And you can see the detailed story from Acts chapter 13, verses 13 through 52. And now, in this sermon, I will ask you all to remember the name of the three cities that Paul and Barnabas visit in order. Just three cities. And the first city that I ask you to remember is Antioch of Pisidia, Antioch. So what Paul and Barnabas did in Antioch was that they went into the synagogue on the Sabbath and preached the gospel of Jesus. They started from the familiar Old Testament stories and connected those stories to Jesus' crucifixion and resurrection. Bible says that when the Gentiles heard this, they were glad and praised the word of the Lord, and they became believers of Christ. However, there were some people who didn't like the message that Paul and Barnabas delivered. Those Jews, they did not like the message of Paul. And I want to make sure that when the Bible says Jews, it's not saying the Jews in general, but those specific Jews who has this zeal for their religion, not knowing that the Son of God actually came in this world. But they just want to follow the law and persecute whoever believes in Jesus. So they persecuted Paul and Barnabas and drove them away out of their city. They hated the message of Paul. So Paul and Barnabas had to move to the next city. They could not share more words of God in Antioch. And the next city that they went, the second city, was Iconium. Remember, the second city, Iconium. So the first city was Antioch, and the second city was Iconium. And you can see the detailed story in chapter 14, verses through 1 to 7. So there in Iconium, they did the same thing. Well, they went into the synagogue and preached the message of Jesus Christ. They did the same thing. And the Bible says that the many Jews and Greeks became believers after hearing Paul and Barnabas' message. However, just like in Antioch, not everyone believed their message. The city was divided into two. Some followed Paul and Barnabas, and some hated their message, and hated so much that they attempted to stone them to death. So after hearing the plan of people that those people are trying to kill them by stoning them, Paul and Barnabas had to run away from Iconium and run away to the neighboring city called Lystra. And you can find the detailed story from chapter 14, verses 8 through 23. So there again, what did they do? They did the same thing. They preached the message of Jesus Christ and even performed a miracle and made a person who never had walked in his life before able to walk on his own feet. People saw that wherever Paul and Barnabas went, they preached the message of Jesus and saw that people following them, believing the words that they deliver. And Jews were very angry about this. So they came to Lystra from Antioch and Iconium to kill Paul and Barnabas and finally stone him and dragged him out of the city, thinking that he was dead. Thankfully, when the disciples came to pick up his body, Paul woke up again, and he was almost killed by spreading the word of Jesus, the gospel. So, do you still remember the three cities that I asked for? The first city, Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. Remember these three cities. So, brothers and sisters, what Paul has experienced here was without any doubt, it was a traumatic event. Even if Paul had said, after experience that, almost being killed, I quit. I cannot do this anymore. No one could blame him. You know, he was almost killed. And think about this. He has sacrificed so many things in his life for this mission to spread the word of Jesus, the gospel. And the consequence of obeying God was being nearly killed. How would you respond to this experience? However, Paul never complains about what happened to him. Instead, when we look at 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 24 through 27, Paul instead boasts his experience of being stoned. I'll read 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 24 to 27. So here Paul says, 5 times I have received from the Jews the 40 lashes minus 1. 3 times I was beaten with rods. Once I received a stoning, which we saw here in Acts 14. And he goes on to say, 3 times I was shipwrecked for a night and a day. I was adrift at sea, on frequent journeys, in danger from rivers, danger from bandits, danger from my own people, danger from Gentiles, danger in the city, danger in the wilderness, danger at sea, danger from false brothers and sisters, in toil and hardship through many a sleepless night, hungry and thirsty, often without food, cold and naked. Paul says, these are the things that I boast. Not the things that I want to forget about, nothing that I want to hide from, but these are the things that I want to boast. Can you understand this? I think it is either that Paul has his head hit by the stone and went crazy, or there's something about Paul. And this is not all. Paul does even more awkward things. And we can see this in today's passage. It is Acts 14, verses 19 through 21. I'll read these verses again. It's verse 19. But Jews came there from Antioch and Iconium and won over the crowds. Then they stoned Paul and dragged him out of the city, supposing that he was dead. But when the disciples surrounded him, he got up and went into the city. The next day he went on with Barnabas to Derbe. And verse 21, after they had proclaimed the good news to that city and had made many disciples, they returned to Lystra, then on to Iconium and Antioch. First of all, if you are almost killed by being stoned, you must be hospitalized and rest for weeks and even for months. But Paul wakes up the very next day and goes out to proclaim the gospel again. More incomprehensible thing is that he goes to Lystra and then on to Iconium and to Antioch. And do you still remember those 3 cities in order? This is the exact reverse of the route that Paul came down. He first came to Antioch, Iconium, and Lystra. And after being stoned to nearly death, and the very next day, after proclaiming the gospel of Jesus, he goes back onto that same route, on reverse order, to Lystra, then Iconium, and to Antioch. If I were Paul, I would not want to go back anywhere near those cities. Remember how I never went back to that shortcut to the grocery store after meeting scary elementary kids gangsters? That was a traumatic event for me. Paul's experience was even worse. This is the experience that should have left the trauma for Paul. But how could Paul have been so brave, courageous, and so sincere to what he has been called for? I'm really desperate to know the reason how Paul could do this. If we look at the second passage that we read together, which is Galatians chapter 6, verse 17, here it says as follows, "From now on, let no one make trouble for me, for I carry the marks of Jesus branded on my body." Here in Galatians 6, Paul says that he has the marks of Jesus branded on his body. And here, the word mark, English word marks, is the translation of the Greek word called stigma. And stigma means wound, scar, just like trauma. It's a wound, it's a hurt, it's the scar. And this stigma, this wound, this scar is perhaps, probably the scar that he gained by spreading the word of Jesus, carrying on the mission that he's been called for. And these scars and this wound, Paul is referring to them as the marks of Jesus. The wound that I referred to in the beginning of the sermon, the trauma, is also wound, as I said. Trauma is a wound that destroys us. It let us fall down. But the wound that Paul is referring to, stigma, in Galatians 6, is a meaningful wound. It's a glorious wound. It makes us rise again. And it reminds of us the calling of God given to all of us. It's the wound, it's a positive wound to grow up again in Christ. What Paul has experienced might have been a trauma for many people. If any of us were nearly killed by anyone, then it surely must have been a traumatic event for us. However, Paul boasts this experience, considering as stigma a glorious mark of Jesus and not trauma that destroys you. How could Paul do that? Why is he so different from others and different from all of us? It was because Paul was so confident and clear that Jesus Christ was the Lord of his life. He was so sure that the purpose of his life is only for Jesus Christ, that whether he lives or he dies does not matter anymore. What matters for him is whether he stands on the side of Jesus or not. Paul was not someone who just stopped in front of the huge wall that blocks his path and just give up. Instead, Paul was the one who sees that wall as an opportunity. An opportunity to consider that wall as a ladder to climb on, not something that blocks you and make you stop from there. Just like how that plant ivy climbs up the walls. I hope whether we encounter troubles and difficulties in our lives, we could consider that wall as an opportunity instead of an obstacle. Because if God is with us, there is no real obstacle in our lives. As I close today's sermon, I would like to share one Korean poem titled Ivy. And because it is translated from Korean into English, we lose the rhymes and subtle nuances, but I hope that this poem still speaks to us. So here it goes, titled Ivy by Do Kyung-won. At times, when we feel that it is a wall, just a wall, then without a word, ivy goes climbing up the wall. At times when we say that it is a wall of despair, with no drop of water, where not one seed can survive, unhurrying, the ivy advances. Hand in hand, several together, it climbs on, a span's breadth at least. Until the despair is all covered in green, it grasps the despair and will not let go. At times when we lower our heads, saying that the wall cannot be climbed, one ivy leaf at the head of thousands of ivy leaves finally climbs the wall. Now, brothers and sisters, let us become a community of faith. They climb the wall together. just like how the ivy holds their hands together and climb the wall together. Let us climb the walls that stand in front of our families, our church, our workplaces, and in front of our many chapters of our lives. Together, as the community of faith, we could climb them up together. Let us make the wounds and scars that we face for living our lives a glorious stigma and not a trauma. With the grace of Christ and as a community of faith, we can surely do this. Amen. At this time, let us now pray for the church and the world. And at this time, we would like to pray for those who are in suffering and pray for our church, the Wyoming Presbyterian Church, to fulfill the mission of Christ to take care of those people who are out there suffering and in tears. Let us pray. Lord, there are so many people who are suffering. Suffering from COVID-19, suffering from economic crises, suffering from relational problems, and so many other issues. Lord, bestow your grace upon them and be their hope to carry on through their lives. Just as Paul took his sufferings as a glorious stigma of Jesus and did not consider them as trauma, Lord, give those who are suffering your courage and strength to stand up again and let them respond sincerely to your calling. Bless the Wyoming Presbyterian Church. Let your church be a community of faith, like the ivy that climbs the wall together. Let them love one another as how Jesus Christ loved his people. Let them support one another so that each person grow up in every way into him who is the head, into Christ. Let them be the church that allows those who are suffering to rise up again, practicing the true love of Christ. I pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now we will continue to lean on the example that Jesus set for us, saying the prayer that he taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Friends, now we are called by God to share our gifts with the church and the world. You can support Wyoming Presbyterian Church's mission by donating a few ways. You can send a check to the church office this week, or you can also give online by visiting our online offering plate at wyomingpresbyterian.org/giving. Thanks for giving abundantly toward our mission. At this time, let us give thanks to God by singing our closing hymn. You can find the words printed in our bulletin. God calls us to be the light in this dark world, never being afraid to take bold risks, standing up to injustice, being Christ's disciples in the world that resists God's saving grace. So go out into this world, knowing that you don't do this alone, but you do this with love of God, the courage of Christ, and the guidance of Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.